Okay, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Free Market Foundation, and thank you for attending today's media briefing. It's fantastic to see so many people here. I am Jason Herbach. I'm a director of the Free Market Foundation and responsible for the health policy unit. It's my pleasure to introduce you to today's speakers and provide some opening remarks on the subject matter. As I'm sure you are aware, in December last year, the government gazetted the demarcation regulations, which basically draw a line in the sand between medical insurance products and medical schemes. The regulations allow gap cover and hospital cash plans, but ban primary health insurance policies, which we believe is a violation of the Constitution. But we have a Patrick Bracher from Norton Rose Fulbright here today, who will elaborate and give his thoughts and ideas on that particular matter. We also have the view that the regulations still do not address the underlying principles driving the perceived need for change, and that's the so-called principle of social solidarity that's contained in the Medical Schemes Act of 1998. And that's because we believe that any social solidarity principle unavoidably raises the price of private medical scheme cover, and that prevents low-income individuals from entering the private medical scheme market. So in the past, what we've seen is that many individuals have opted instead for hospital cash plans, and previously there were no limits in place for these plans, but the new regulations impose a limit of 3,000 rand per day and 20,000 rand per annum. And gap cover policies will be limited to a maximum payout of 150,000 rand per year. The real question, however, is why would government step in to prevent mutually consenting free adults from entering into private contracts with insurers to minimize their risk of catastrophic care, especially when it would lessen the pressure on an already overburdened public healthcare sector. So when the new limits are implemented, in my opinion, I think the rich people will be able to afford to continue their medical scheme contributions, and they'll be able to comply with the new regulations, but poor people will not be able to afford this form of social engineering, and they'll be denied private cover. The Department of Health has asked the Council for Medical Schemes for an exemption for a period of 2 years for existing clients from the primary healthcare insurance before the primary healthcare insurance policies are banned. And this exemption period has been ostensibly requested so that the departments can do further research into introducing or developing low-cost medical scheme benefit options. But don't hold your breath. The Department of Health has been talking about or discussing the introduction of low-cost medical scheme benefit options for at least the last 10 years. And we can expect further delays while the government continues to marginalize the private sector and in order to make way for the National Health Insurance Scheme. So without much further ado, I'd like to introduce you to our first speaker. It's Mike. You would have seen his bio and Patrick's bio in the invitation that you received to be here today. So without much further ado, please welcome Patrick. Mike, sorry.
Is the mic on? Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Thank you as well for your time for being here today. Obviously, important stuff we have to talk about, and we obviously feel quite strongly about them. But without delaying too much, let's go into it. And Jason, thanks very much for the introductory overview. So from my side, I'm going to go through 5 points today. It'll only take about 2.5 hours, maybe another 40 minutes on top of that, but don't stress too much. Legislative history on health policy. I think it's quite interesting to have a look at I go back about 25 years. Look at our disease burden. A lot of people really don't look at that. They just sort of look at the funding components. And then the big question, can the state deliver NHR? I think it's obviously a hot topic at the moment. The existing private sector, have a look at some issues around that. I see some health economists here, so I'm really nervous. and then options for the future is to where we can go from, and maybe just some ideas to explore. So let's start and have a look at that legislative timeline. So I go back to 1992, so quite some time back, 25 years if my math serves me right. And under the old NAT government, it was then Dr. Rena Fenter, who was the health minister, who changed the Medical Schemes Act into a risk-rated model. So medical schemes could risk rate, they could decline applications, very much like insurance companies would operate. sometime after, well, after 1994, the ANC wrote its first health policy paper. It was written by Drs. Jonathan Brimberg and Olive Shosana, which then ultimately led into the Taylor Committee, which proposed the social health insurance proposal. SHR, NHR, don't get too hung up on the names, they're pretty much the same thing, just rose by another name. Preceding that, though, the Medical Schemes Act was then changed in 1998, and I'll touch on quite a bit of the implications of what happened with that. The Taylor Committee had started in 1997 with its work, so it took 5 years. It was in fact a very comprehensive policy proposal. It never got enacted, though, because by 2008, the SHR had been replaced by NHR, which was the sort of political flavor of the month then. And subsequent to that, we've had a green paper in 2011 and then a white paper in 2015. And the last piece of legislation that sort of affects the healthcare industry was the now recent demarcation regulations, which is exactly what we're here to talk about. What I want to point out, though, is in terms of those things, the two policy changes that happened, one in 95 and one in 2008, both were preceded by political change. I mean, that's fairly common. Okay, political change normally means policy change. And one might sort of wonder what's going to happen post-2019. Maybe we'll have a policy change and something more rational, but maybe the tooth fairy will come out. I don't know. But okay, but ultimately, looking through the whole history, not much has changed in 20 years. The only things that have really changed are the private sector, Medical Schemes Act 98, demarcation regulations. Public sector has hardly changed at all. There's actually been nothing. Fundamentally, it's no different to what it was 25 years ago. It really hasn't changed very much. Looking at the past 2 years, just in a shorter time frame, it was 2 years ago that the LCBO, or low-cost benefit option proposal, was put on the table. As Jason mentioned, it's not the first time. It was proposed in 2004-05 as well, and it was called LIMS, low-income medical scheme, so it's born with a new name now, low-cost benefit option. But it wasn't really endorsed and coming from the Department of Health. It really came more from industry encouraging the regulator to have a look at this. And that was actually ultimately its downfall, which you'll see in September 2015, the minister actually instructed Council for Medical Schemes to withdraw the LCBO proposal. But once this LCBO proposal was on the table, July 2015, Treasury released the third version of the demarcation regulations because they now were comfortable that there was a primary care option in place that will be governed under the Council for Medical Schemes. And so the demarcation regulations excluded primary care, even though many of us as stakeholders involved in the process were encouraging them to try and include it so that we could start rolling out healthcare. Obviously, after it was withdrawn, that created some problems for Treasury, but I'll touch on that just now. No surprises as to why LCBO was pulled, well, in my opinion, because 3 months later the NHR white paper came out. And obviously that spoke about a national solution. The whole country will be covered under NHR, a single payer fund. I can't even imagine the magnitude of it, let alone what will go on with it. But and there would be no place for medical schemes. The minister's contradicted himself in the press subsequent to that, saying, no, definitely private will go. But if you actually read the white paper, it says it's going to be taken away. And the only place for medical schemes will be for any services that the NHR would not cover. So we obviously have some disparity in terms of what the policy position is. Because LCBO was withdrawn, demarcation regulations were now some concerns around the constitutionality, so Treasury held back on the regulations. But in the meantime, what they had done is negotiated with Council for Medical Schemes to come to an agreement in terms of bringing an exemption in place, which is exactly what they did towards the end of last year. And then by December 2016, they gazetted the demarcation regulations on the knowledge and strength that the Council for Medical Schemes would issue an exemption for low-cost primary products. Okay, so in their view, constitutionally, they're covered now. And we've actually seen it in writing that Treasury does believe that that's their position, and obviously Patrick's going to give us a much better overview on where he feels that is just now. So what is our current position in terms of healthcare? So in terms of alternative lower cost health insurance, there's an arbitrary 2-year exemption. And I call it arbitrary because it's at the behest of the council. It's not statutory, it's not contained in law, it's purely an exemption being given by a regulator, and hospital covers being denied entirely. As far as we understand, the exemption hasn't yet come out, so we don't know the details, and we're obviously anxiously waiting to see what the details are. But as far as we understand, hospital cover will be denied entirely, and it will only be an exemption framework for primary care. Low-cost benefit option will then be revived and built through the Medical Schemes Act, which will require an amendment to that act. And then primary care insurance products that exist at that time, once that's enabled, will transition into LCBO. So the questions that one would have to ask for the uninsured market is, if you're an insurer, why would you bother investing in low-cost product? Because it's going to be taken away from you in 2 years' time or whatever time frame it is. So therefore, we don't see primary care actually growing or expanding, because why would you bother? I mean, it doesn't make any commercial sense whatsoever. And then the other question is, how long will LCBO take? 2 years, it's an amendment to an act. I don't know, Patrick, probably far better position to answer that. But the demarcation regulations themselves have been going on for like 15 or 16 years. That's just a set of regulations as opposed to an act of parliament. So anyway, I question the 2 years. So in the meantime, what I'm saying or trying to get to is that people are being denied healthcare. Nothing's going to be happening. Okay. Remembering that LCBO, as I mentioned earlier, started in 2005 with LIMS, and then again in 2015, and both times it's been stopped. So if we look at our current policy, how do we stand as a country? At the bottom, all citizens relying on the Department of Health is approximately 47 million who do not have access to healthcare. And then at the top, you have the expensive medical schemes, and there are approximately 8.8 million citizens who sit in that category. And in the middle, you have zilch. Okay, nothing. So if you can't afford a medical aid, you can't buy anything else. That's basically what these regulations are saying, or to put it in a nutshell. And NHR will come along and replace everything at some stage in the future. 2025, it's not too far away. I think they're running out of time. Anyway, okay, so that's a recap in just terms of some of the legal framework, where how we've built up to that. And as I said, let's have a look at our disease burden, because I think it's often ignored. Disease burden is measured in something called a disability-adjusted life year. Marinay, thanks for some stats here. And it's measured as a number per 1,000 lives. So if you can see, if you read on the Tunisia example, it follows 158 dailies, as I like to call them, per 1,000 lives. And what I've done is I've put together a basket here of developing economies to have a look at what the level of disease burden is. And then let's have a look at what South Africa's is as we compare to developing countries. So yes, we have a massive disease burden, and it's not something you really can ignore. So when you're designing healthcare systems, you can't ignore this. You have to take it into account. It's also the type of disease burden. Is it more communicable disease or non-communicable? That determines what your healthcare provision is going to be. But is South Africa really out of sync with Africa? And actually, no. So Africa's really a problem as it stands on its own. I'll show you on the next slide here. These are the regions as defined by the World Health Organization, and then the disease burden in each. So you see there's six regions that are defined, and you can see Africa stands out head and shoulders above the rest of the world in terms of disease burden. The global average is 230. South Africa is actually almost spot on double the world average in terms of our disease burden. Okay, so we have a problem in terms of disease in the country. And what's also interesting for me, and kind of sad in a way, is where this disease burden is carried. So if we have a look at high-income countries, on the left, you see there that only 9% of the disease burden in high-income countries is carried in children under the age of 14. But a very, very different story when we get to the low-mid-income countries. So that a big chunk of disease burden is being carried by young children. If we measure children from age under 18, in low to middle income countries, the disease burden is actually more than 50% amongst children. Okay, so quite an interesting aspect to look at in terms of where the disease burden lies. We're going to have some Prozac on the way out in the door when we finish this, to make sure everyone's feeling better. Okay, can the state deliver NHR? So I just look at a couple of high-level figures. Marinay, thanks very much. I read all your material. Okay, so it happens to be here today. Health economists based in Cape Town are called Econics. They published a paper in June last year what they estimated the NHR would cost in its current form to run, an additional 200 billion rand from what the current public health budget is. So if we consider that SARS collected 1.07 trillion in the last tax year, what the NHR is proposing is a 20% increase across all tax collections in South Africa. I mean, it's just simply unattainable. It's impossible. If we look at 2017, Treasury battled to find an extra 28, let alone almost 10 times that amount. So from a financing point of view, it just seems inconceivable to me. We'd have to have growth rates of 10% a year for a decade at least, probably, to come even close to trying to raise that. And then the other side, I mean, health systems are made up of who's going to pay and who's going to provide the care. So that's the other aspect, is do we have any doctors? So the NHR pilot sites, 10 of them got up and running, and they ran for a few years. And in 2015, it was published by the Department of Health that they'd only managed to fill 19% of the posts. So they've only got one-fifth of the doctors they need to run the sites. So, but it's not surprising if you have a look at the availability of providers here. If we have a look at the stat just on five categories of providers, and this is the number of citizens per one provider, and I've compared state versus private. State, you'll see there with GPs, closer than all the other categories, but still a number out. The typical sort of number you want to look at with a GP is certainly less than 2,000, probably optimally around 1,500 patients per GP. I mean, it does vary according to disease burden and demographic, but it's sort of rough numbers. So you can see state is way out there. Specialists also vary significantly. Dentists, to give an idea. So we worked it out just very roughly. How many consults can a dentist do in a day? He works 11.25 months a year. So he only goes on holiday for 3 weeks, not too great. Basically, it means a dentist would see one patient every 16 years. So it's not exactly a capacity to deliver. Not if you've got toothache now, 16 years is a long time to wait. Okay, so look, I mean, and I'm just really looking at the high-level challenges around it. So in short, for me, the issue is that the NHR has a funding problem, it has a shortage of doctor problem, we have a massive disease burden, as I saw there, way over. And what I haven't touched on is the thought of a bureaucracy the size of something like an NHR. Just sort of looking at the ratio of numbers of medical scheme administration companies to the memberships they look after, an NHR, just the funding side of it, would probably be a few hundred thousand employees to run a countrywide medical aid to cover everything. Don't know if you'd agree with that, Marina. Rough, arbitrary number. But anyway, and I mean, let's be honest, South Africa has not exactly shone out in terms of public administration capability. So anyway, I'm not cynical, I promise. Okay, so existing private sector, let's have a look at that. I wanted to start by saying here that I'm going to give you some hospital stats on costs and how they've grown in the last few years, but I'm not putting all the blame on the hospitals. So I'm just clarifying, because I'll go into some other figures now. So what I did here is I took hospital costs for the last 25 years, and they restated in 2015 prices. Okay. So what we see here is the growth in real terms from 1990. I hope you can all read that. Let's just see this pointer over here. So there, it's just over 1,000, and in 2015 it's almost 6,000 rand. If we draw a trend line through the 90s and then do a regression line through the last 15 years, we see an inflection point in the two trends, which is exactly when the Medical Schemes Act came into place. So that's when open enrollment came in, no underwriting, very much a social rights framework, which is great and laudable, but it doesn't have the protection mechanisms that are needed in terms of a system like that. So this thing will actually also do the trick. So just to give you perspective, right now, if costs had stayed on the trend line of there, the hospital costs would have been significantly lower. It's now 59% higher than what it would have been had it stayed on that original trend line. I'm just going to go through this graph to give you a perspective of this is a typical distribution of lifetime hospital costs. You have age at the bottom all the way through. And naturally, as we get older, you know, from young, your healthcare costs go up. But it's not linear, it's logarithmic. So the 20-year difference between a 20-year-old and a 40-year-old, the cost difference is, say, an index of 100, but the difference between a 40-year-old and a 60-year-old is 200. So as you go up this scale becomes logarithmic. So the problem is if your demographic profile in your medical scheme market's getting worse, and it is getting worse, your costs then exponentially rise. So this is why I'm not saying this is squarely at the feet of the hospitals, because if your demographic profile is getting worse, your costs are going to rise. If we have a look at another, did I jump a slide there? No. If we have a look at another factor, chronic disease prevalence per 1,000 lives, we also see that chronic disease is growing. I haven't updated this for a while, but I know each year it's in the council's report, and they're reporting on the chronic disease getting worse and worse. And I see the medicine clearing guys here today, so it is getting worse. Am I right in the stats? Okay. So, and that's a significant problem. Why? If you measure the cost of hospitalization of a non-chronic member across all ages, regardless of age, just take the hospital cost of a non-chronic beneficiary and just index that at 100, the hospital cost of chronic members is 2.2 times higher on average. I've seen this in a number of data analyses that I've done. It might vary a little bit, but it's significant. So if you have a 1% increase in chronic members, you're going to have a much bigger increase in your hospital costs. Okay. And then one other factor just to look at in terms of the medical scheme demographics is this year, family size. So suddenly, medical scheme members have been getting, families have been getting shrinking. Don't know quite why, but anyway. They're obviously taking dependents off their medical scheme. So the employer is saying you have to belong to medical aid. It's a condition of employment. They're on a cost to company structure. They're saying, I can't afford it. I'll take my child off, or I'll take my spouse off. Okay, so the family size is shrinking, and again, the problem is they're not going to take someone off who's unhealthy. They'll only take them off if they're healthy. So therefore, again, your remaining risk pool that stays behind becomes worse, and all those cost problems start coming in. So, and the real point that I'm trying to get to here in terms of an analysis of the private sector is this situation here. So we're going to look at CPI. This is medical scheme contributions, and this is real medical inflation. So CPI for the period 2000 to 2015 has been 5.8%. The increases in medical scheme contributions have been 9.4%. And that's often touted as the figure for medical inflation. But the problem with that number is that it ignores these things. It ignores downgrades. There's been massive downgrades over the years, so people going from the high-level options down to the low-level options. So if you measure one member who was on a comprehensive plan this year and went to a low-cost option next year, they're actually going to bring in negative inflation into those figures. So that 9.4 is not a solid representation, and then you also have out-of-pocket cost. So what the figure is, I don't know. Marine, why don't you do a study? I mean, this would be great. No. I did have a number in there, and I thought, no, I better take it out. Look, I would, my absolute guess. I mean, I'm not saying this is a study at all, but it must be a reasonably high. I would guess 2 percentage points higher than that 9.4, 11.4. I don't know. Anyway, but it is high. I mean, there's no question. When you see, if you were to go back, find your medical aid and ask them for a brochure. They keep all these things in stock. And ask them for a benefit brochure from 2000. And ask them now for a benefit. Well, you can get your benefit brochure on the internet now. It's like two different worlds. You wouldn't even recognize it. The benefits were so rich then, and they're so stripped down now. That's nowhere even close. Okay, so two other factors that unfortunately put pressure on the private sector is this. This SARS took away, well, didn't take it away, but dramatically reduced the deductibility of medical scheme contributions. So from 2012 to 2013, with a conversion from a deduction to a credit, it reduced the deductibility from 64 billion to 15 billion in one fell swoop. So in 2013, there was not only the medical scheme contribution increases, but also the loss of tax deductibility on top of that. And then the last point on this is just to have a look at employer subsidy on medical schemes and what's happening with that. So just in the last year, it's kind of always stayed around this 55 to 60% market. Suddenly now it's dropped off in 2015. This is out of the SARS reports, the tax publication. And if you take out GEMS, because remember GEMS is, all GEMS members get very rich subsidies. So if you take them out of the picture, then we're down to about a third. So what this means is companies are converting to cost to company structures, and then members are now carrying the above inflation cost increases in their medical scheme contributions out of their own pocket. So if they get a 5% salary increase, they might only take home 3% more, depending on what's happened there. So that's also putting more and more pressure onto consumers. So the change there is 16% reduction all around. If we look at the private sector alone, the level of which subsidy occurs has dropped by 27%. Okay, so my opinion, medical inflation is running somewhere close to double CPI. I'm not going to put an absolute number on it. But with favorable consumer rights and no protection mechanisms, it's an unsustainable structure. It's not suitable to finance healthcare, not in the way it's structured in South Africa. If we had mandatory cover, it would be great, but we don't. And I don't think in our country we could bring in mandatory cover. I think it's suitable for high-income countries with low levels of unemployment. So really the only way to fix it is to move towards a risk-rated environment. So options for the future. Let's look at this demarcation regulation. So these have raised some questions, which Jason did allude to. But I'd ask three fundamental questions here for me. Why replicate the provisions of the Medical Schemes Act? We've just looked at how it's not working. Okay, and I mean, you don't have to really dig that deep to see it's not working. So why replicate those provisions? Why deny the constitutional right to healthcare for people who can't afford medical aid? Obviously, Patrick's going to delve into that a bit more. And then one fundamental for me, which I've never really understood, and I've raised this with them in the consultation process, is we've got the biggest inquiry happening in the healthcare industry ever in this country. And it's wide-reaching, it's comprehensive. I've been impressed with what the panel is doing. Why ignore it? It's coming out in a year's time. We're now creating legislation, fundamental legislation in healthcare, but at the same time, the Minister of Health, it was at his behest that the inquiry was done, and he's now saying, well, let's ignore that and pass legislation. Doesn't make any sense. Surely as a regulator, you want to say, well, let's hear what this inquiry has to say. Maybe their recommendation is to reverse all of this. Anyway, so those are the three questions that I would raise in terms of the demarcation regulations. And then just as a policy position around not just NHR, but the whole picture, public and private. Our disease burden is very high. We've got a shortage of providers in public. There's no budget for it. We have an exclusionary, expensive private sector. So we've now cemented the medical scheme world as exclusively to cover that. And most people can't get into it because it's too expensive and it's unsustainable. So yeah, I really raise a lot of questions around this. However, I'd like to leave you with the last two slides with a little bit of good news. Maybe it's some hope of where we're going forward. If we have a look at global health expenditure and split it between developing economies and developed economies, we see in 1995, only 10% of the world's healthcare spend happened in developing economies. By 2012, that had grown to 21%, and by 2022, it's projected to grow to 33%. Now, this growth is what should be happening in South Africa, because we're a developing economy. This comes from a combination of public and private spending, but public can't do it all on its own. It should really be doing it together, so enabling expansion of healthcare. And Brazil's a great example. Brazil's healthcare system has its problems, like almost all healthcare systems do. But they boast something. They have the world's largest public healthcare system. It covers 150 million lives. It's about three quarters of their population. But right next door to that exists the world's second largest private healthcare system, next only to the US. So they can coexist perfectly. Why can't we do the same? Thank you very much for your time.
In my office at Norton Rose Fulbright, I have a file. It's that big, and it's called South African Insurance Association Demarcation Regulations. I went last night, and you page back to page one, and I started discussing demarcation regulations with the Council for Medical Schemes in February 2000. So by the time the demarcation regulations come into full force in January 2018, we would have been messing around with this issue for a full 20 years. I'd like to say two things about the first meeting I had with them, and I went with the South African Insurance Association. I was with Caroline De Silva, who is now at the FSB, but unfortunately not in the medical section. And two things happened at the meeting. First of all, I also had an actuary with me, and they said to the council, what is your evidence that insurance products affect medical schemes? And that question has been asked ever since the year 2000. Mike will tell you that has been asked over and over and over at meetings. In September 2016, when they were justifying these latest regulations, there's a nice, well, not nice, 57-page document from National Treasury explaining why these regulations are being brought into force. And not one word is said in those 57 pages about they keep saying insurance products are messing up medical schemes, but they never give a statistic, and they've never done it. Have they ever done a study? Not to my knowledge. The other thing that happened at the meeting was quite curious, because I said to the then registrar of medical schemes, I said, what will you say to my mother, who's been paying an insurance product for the last 15 years, and in January next year, you draw a line through her insurance and you say you can't have it anymore? I said, what will you do about that problem? He said to me, my job is not to solve problems. I wrote it down and I said, Patrick, his name was also Patrick, and I said, Patrick, I'm going to hold that against you one day, but then he left the council, so I've never been able to. But the other thing I have to tell you about accident and health products is that they are as old as insurance itself. If you go back to the law reports in England, 1850s, 1860s, 1870s, when the railways were first being developed, if you bought a train ticket, it's called voucher insurance. That train ticket gave you accident and health insurance for your train journey. If you bought the daily newspaper, there's a little coupon insurance, and you got a day's insurance, accident and health. If you bought a weekly magazine, you got a week's insurance. It really is as old as insurance, and I can show you the law reports where they refer to it. So it's not that the insurance industry stepped on the shoes of the medical schemes industry after 1998. They were there already filling in those gaps. Now, the basis of it all is the definition in the Medical Schemes Act of the business of a medical scheme. That's where it all starts. And what it says is that the business of a medical scheme is to defray medical expenses in return for a premium. And they say unless you get some special exemption, nobody else can defray medical expenses in return for a premium. So if you're an insurance company and you want to defray medical expenses under your policy, you have to fit in now from January next year with the demarcation regulations. Now there's one basic principle of legality and constitutional law, and that is what you do has to be reasonable and rational. And if you just listen to Mike, you can't find any rationality in these demarcation regulations. And the primary irrationality is the one he ended with. The Competition Commission is doing a great job looking into the position. So what is the rationale for introducing regulations now from the 1st of April, taking away people's rights from the 1st of April when we don't know what the position is? Now, the people I'm talking about here are let's call them the disadvantaged people. Right as I'm talking now, there are clever advocates in the Constitutional Court talking about what they call the poorest of the poor. That whole SASA thing is going on. What I'm talking about, those people who are not advantaged in the sense they're earning enough to join a medical scheme. They are below that, and they're not the poorest of the poor because they're earning a regular salary, and they can go out and they can buy a hospital cash plan from an insurance company. Now, imagine if somebody said to you today, if the Gazette published in December, coming into force on the 1st of April, saying, we are going to outlaw medical schemes from the 1st of January next year. That would be the same result for me as it would be for some person who has got a hospital cash plan they rely on in order to get hospitalization, or to get entrance to hospital from a reasonable premium that they can afford. Now, the insurers have been there all the time, and what the basis of this is Section 27 of the Bill of Rights. And I always say this is my favorite book. I don't know if you know, I have a radio program on the Bill of Rights, and That's why it's a little bit dog-eared. But Section 27, and I'm going to read it to everyone. Everyone has the right to have access to healthcare services. That is a primary right. It goes on to say that the state must take reasonable measures to achieve progressive realization of these rights. But it doesn't, just because they've got to be progressive realization doesn't mean it's not a primary right. And David Bilchitz, if you know him, professor of law at UJ, has lectured on this and he's written articles on this. There's a primary right to healthcare services, access to healthcare services. And that is what is being taken away. And if it says that the government must take measures to achieve progressive realization, well, the very opposite has happened, because they're now taking away rights from January next year. From 1994, when the interim constitution said the same thing, they should have been progressively realizing this right. Well, they haven't been. The insurance companies have been progressively realizing this right, and is now being taken away from the 1st of January next year, after 20 years of nothing. The other problem, in the other issue in the Constitution is the property section, Section 25. And the property section says you can't take away anybody's property without compensation, and you can't do it arbitrarily. Now, there was a very interesting case in the Eastern Cape last year where one of the big supermarket chains, I've forgotten which one, they wanted to build, they had a liquor outlet in their retail supermarket store. Eastern Cape government passed a law and said you may not have liquor in the same store as foodstuffs because children walk around, etc. You have to set up a separate office, separate building, separate walls. And they went to court, and the Constitutional Court reaffirmed that property doesn't mean property in the ordinary sense of the word. Property means property is a right. And a license is a property, and an insurance policy is a property. If you've been paying an insurance policy for 20 years, that is property, and the government are not allowed to take it away from you without compensation, substituting something else. And we had that whole thing when the new mining laws came into force. And I'll come back to what they've offered in substitution. The Constitution then goes on to say in Section 36, if you want, you can limit rights. You're allowed to limit rights, and we do it all the time. We say discrimination, but you have separate toilets for men and women as a nice empirical example. But you can only limit rights if you do it on a reasonable and justifiable basis, on the basis of what is a democratic state, recognizing dignity and equality. Now, those words are important because there's nothing less dignified than being ill and not being getting health care. There are lots of judgments that make that very example. Your right to bodily integrity is a right to dignity. Then you've got a right to equality. They can't take away rights from the people who can't afford medical schemes and leave me in the pound seats. Of course, Mike made a point which just occurred to me. The people making these regulations are all members of GEMS. Now, they're fine, thank you. They've got a very nice, very high benefit scheme paid for by the state, paid for by us, I suppose. And they say, well, we're all right, so what about you? Take the rights away. Now, what have they offered in exchange? And this is what the 57-page document says. They say we've got to have social solidarity, and that means that the young people subsidize the older people. Well, of course, that does happen in medical, and I get closer and closer to appreciating that. That does happen in the medical schemes world. But it doesn't happen in any other world, you see. So they're sacrificing the people who can only afford an insurance policy in order to keep social solidarity among the advantaged people, which is also unpleasant. And what are they offered in return? The National Health Scheme, 200 billion rand, which we haven't got. What do you say, 2025? So between now and 2025, that doesn't help you. They said there's a competition commission and they're going to solve your problems. And the Competition Commission, after the Gazette came out, said, well, we're going to put it off till next year. We can't finish in time. So that's not on the horizon for the deprived. They said, extraordinarily, we've got Twin Peaks legislation. Twin Peaks is a thing that says we're going to look after the prudential side of financial institutions and make sure they stay solvent. And we're going to have a market conduct thing which will make sure everybody treats customers fairly. Now, that's nice. Treating customers fairly is nice. But what is the government doing about treating customers fairly? That band of people who are having rights taken away from them, there's no fairness in it. There's no legality in it at all. And then we heard about the low-cost benefit option. It used to be called LIMS. And that's been going for, what, 10 years, 2004? It was first discussed when I went to the early meetings with the Council for Medical Schemes to say, well, what are you going to do about this? They said, look, we're going to try and find a solution for these people. Now, 20 years later, literally, well, it's 1998, the Acts came into force, nothing has been done about that. It came on the table, people put a lot of effort into it, taken off the table because of an unaffordable national health insurance. So nothing progressive has happened in that regard. The thing that the last budget, they said they're going to start with national health, and they said it was going to be maternal care, psychiatric, elderly, and disabled. That's a very small section of what it is, and we haven't got the money for even that. Now, this is not a small matter, because the figures that I'm now going to give you come out of the government document that I mentioned to you. There are at least 2 million people who have hospital cash plan type insurance. So 2 million people from the 1st of January next year will have rights taken away from them. 2 million people. Some of them will carry on if they got lucky enough to be with long-term insurers, and I'll come back to that. There are 100,000 people on gap cover. Gap cover is when you take out cover, your medical scheme has a limit on benefits, and you take out an insurance policy which said, well, I spend more than that because I get a serious disease, I can take out gap cover. Now, I spoke to an insurer yesterday who, for a really modest premium, you can get 500,000 Rand gap cover. That's one of the many products in the market that allow that. Now, the gap cover that you're going to be allowed under the regulations is 150,000 Rand per person per year. If you're unlucky enough to get two serious diseases in a year, you're going to be in trouble. And there's a very interesting phrase in this 57-page document. They said they made it 150,000 Rand because they didn't want people to be significantly out of pocket. So they've capped it. And there's no rationale, you see, in capping it at 150,000, because what they say is people are going to buy down medical schemes, they're going to take out a lower medical scheme, and then you're going to cap it up with insurance. But there are other ways of dealing with that. You see, what Section 36 says, if you want to limit a right, you must look at the least intrusive way of limiting that right. And there are many other ways of dealing with that. The other thing that they've done now, you go now with a hospital cash plan, you pay a modest premium, they really are modest premiums, and when you go to hospital, you'll get a daily amount to pay your hospital expenses while you're there. You can get a lump sum up front because, you know, when you walk through the door, they'll say to you, look, we're not letting you into that bed until you give me 20,000 Rand. And that is what the hospital cash plans do. Now you've got a product which gives you a daily allowance, up to 3,000 Rand a day, daily allowance whilst you're in hospital as a result of accident or ill health. But you're not allowed to spend it on, you are allowed to spend it, but you're not allowed to give it to the doctor, you're not allowed to make it over to the hospital. It can't be for incurring medical expenses. You just get a daily allowance because you're losing income. Now, the sad result of that is quite important, because if you are getting 3,000 Rand a day to lie in a hospital bed, and you're not paying the hospital, there are going to be people crooking the system. There are going to be people who talk to the nurse, say, well, please keep me here for another week, because I can make another 35,000 Rand. Bad mathematics, 21,000 Rand. Well, this is inflation, medical inflation. So that to me is a serious matter. It also means that when you walk into hospital, you can't say, look, I'll sign a cession in your favor of my 20,000 Rand benefit. Please let me into the hospital. Because you're not allowed to do that. You can't make it over to the medical people. You can't spend it. You can't say, this goes towards my hospital expenses. And then you don't lie in hospital bed, because you're not getting any more money in your pocket. You're just getting your hospital expenses paid. So what they've substituted is no good. Then, because of the statistics that you saw, you can get full cover by an insurance company for HIV and AIDS, for tuberculosis, and for malaria. Is that the full list? I think, yeah. Those four things. Now, why those four things? I mean, why stop there? We know we've got a big HIV and AIDS problem, and I devised insurance products 15 years ago to deal with AIDS treatment, because it is so serious. But just on my desk this week came this thing from Health E, but suddenly diabetes has emerged as the biggest killer of South African women, and the second biggest killer overall, according to 2015 death statistics. So why not diabetes? Why malaria and not diabetes? I mean, as I said, laws have to be rational. They have to be reasonable and rational. If you're changing a law and limiting a right, it has to be reasonable and rational. The highest killer, and another piece of paper crossed my desk this week, said the highest killer in KwaZulu-Natal is strokes, because there's a high blood pressure problem there. Now, why not that? That's the people of KwaZulu-Natal are entitled to some sort of equal benefit. Equality is the principle that I mentioned to you. And of course, for all these diseases, I can get something out of my medical scheme if I get diabetes or a stroke, but they can get nothing now because it's just a daily benefit if it puts them in hospital. The other thing they've done is they've given international travel. If you're in a country where you're not ordinarily resident, you can get full cover for your medical costs. It's not quite clear what happens if something happens to you nasty while you're in London and you come back here for the rest of your treatment. Can you cover that under your travel policy? There's a nice interpretation of the word that would allow, words that would allow that, but they're not normally interested in nice interpretations by me. Then you can get full cover from an insurance company for emergency treatment and emergency transport and evacuation, helicopters, ambulances, and emergency treatment. You see, the difficulty is always where the line is drawn between when the emergency stops and the ordinary treatment starts. So where do you draw that line? How rational is that in relation to giving people rights? And under the Long-Term Insurance Act, there's an interesting thing. You can get full cover for frail care. And that means you can get cover for people assisting you with the activities of daily living. That's interesting because it means if you don't lie in hospital and you go home, you can get your expenses paid at home. You can have a nurse come into your house and look after you, and you can get full cover under an insurance policy. If you prefer to stay in hospital because you don't want nurses around your house, you won't have any cover except for the daily allowance if you're lucky. So none of this is rational. Now, there are good things about regulations because it does give people the right to get insurance without having somebody say to them, well, what is your pre-existing condition? But we were just talking at tea time, you know, now they've got drugs which are very specific to me. So if it says they can't underwrite me specifically, then it distorts the whole concept of insurance where you can underwrite people according to a risk profile. And by doing that, you keep the premiums down. And Mike has illustrated the fact that by not doing that, the premiums just simply have to go up. If we have community rating and equal premiums for everybody in a certain band or group, the premiums have to go up. And we see how unsustainable medical schemes have become, except for those who can afford to fork out a lot of money all the time. So it's good in principle, but it's not the rational way of dealing with it. And Mike has demonstrated that in slide after slide after slide as we have gone through it. The other thing that they suggest in this document is this. There are products out there which have been also with us for as long as I can remember. And that, for instance, is a group personal accident policy. If you're lucky enough to be in a big industry or a big factory or something, they'll say, look, we've got a group personal accident policy for you. If you have a health event, if you're injured, or if you have a health event, we will give you a lump sum for disability and we will pay your medical expenses. Now that now is that medical expense slice. And I looked at a Google last night, and the people are giving up to 100,000 Rand in medical expenses under group personal accident policy, some of the insurers in this very town. That's now the lines drawn to that. No, that's the business of a medical scheme. The same thing is in every motor policy you've got. There's a little thing there that says if your passenger's injured, we'll pay you up to, it used to be 30,000 Rand or something, medical expenses. That's theoretically gone out the window. Worse than that, if you've got dread disease cover, I saw 100,000 Rand for medical expenses when you have a dread disease and they start paying out your life policy early. Now that too will not, that will be the business of a medical scheme. They defray all medical costs apparently. So you have to go and join a medical scheme to get these rights. Then Mike spoke to us about primary health plans. Is that what they're called? Primary health plans. primary health services. Now, those are those products where you go, and there's some nice ones in town. You can, as a person who can't afford a medical scheme, they'll give you 3 visits to a GP every year. They'll give you chronic medicines and ordinary medicines up to certain limits, 1 visit to the dentist and 1 visit to the ophthalmologist or whatever. Nice little package and hospital added onto that. Now, 2 things have happened there. One thing, they talk about a 2-year exemption while they bring in the mystical low-cost benefit scheme. If they can do that in 2 years after 20, it'd be surprising. But the 2-year exemption for primary health care products. But what is rumored, and it almost says it in the document, is that it won't include the hospital benefit. The hospital one, you have to go and get the lump sum one that I spoke to you about. Now, 2 things are wrong with that. A, it's 2 years, so Mike's absolutely right. I mean, if you've got developing your business plan as an insurer, you're not going to say, oh, good, I've got 2 years to introduce a primary healthcare product, because by the time you've got it up and running and done the marketing, your acquisition cost will never get paid back in 2 years. So it's not attractive to anybody, so it's not helpful to anybody. You know, we live in a time now, I mean, the debate is going on in the USA. You see that they drawing a line through Obamacare and what is going to be in its place. And they talk about, some people say 14 million people, some people say 24 million people. But that percentage of people in the States who are getting affected by that line being drawn through laws is about the same percentage as the 2-3 million people plus group personal accident policy people who are having lines drawn through their policies here. So it's a serious issue. I mean, the stuff I'm getting past my desk all the time is about Obamacare, but we have the issue here for the same percentage of people, the same even greater percentage of people who are not getting access to these products from January next year. So it's something that just has to be dealt with. The other irrational thing is this: if you are lucky enough to go and get your accident and health policy from a long-term insurer, a life insurer, and not from a short-term insurer, an indemnity insurer, say you went to Sun Lum and not Sun Tum, your products will carry on after the 1st of January next year. And if you went to the short-term product rather than that, they'll draw a line through your policy in January next year. Now, there again, rational, reasonable, isn't. It just isn't. And I've written about this, we've made objections to the Treasury, and if you look through their 57-page document, it's not recognized. Mike has had the meetings. I read the other day, and I sent Mike a copy, there was the National Treasury gave a briefing to the Parliamentary Committee on Finance, I think, not health, it was finance, wasn't it? I mean, if you read that briefing, there's not a word of what I've just said, not a word of it saying, look, sorry, we'll be taking away a few people's rights. They just say, well, social solidarity, you people at the bottom just have to contribute to the good of the country. So what we've got now is not treating customers fairly. The government are not treating their customers fairly, and that those people are affected. The insurance companies can do very little about it. If you want to challenge this, you have to go to the Constitutional Court, and I hope somebody will. But it's you know, the trouble with access to justice is that it's slow and expensive. You know, if you go to the Constitutional Court, you've got to, when you get to court, you've got to produce 21 copies of the papers just for the judge and their clerks. I mean, that can cost you 600,000 rand in production time. So it's not access that's easy, and it takes time, obviously, to get through the lower court. And by January next year, unless you get some urgency out of the court, it's not going to work. And of course, insurers, I mean, insurers, a lot of them are just reluctant to do anything about it. You take on your regulator, and you get punished. It's a known thing. So it's a sad case that all these people at the bottom haven't got anybody to protect them. I haven't seen any of the NGOs. I tried to phone one this morning. Section 27, in fact, they concentrate on Section 27 to see if perhaps they're going to be doing something. But there's a desperate need here for the voice, and that's why I'm so glad to have this opportunity, and thanks to the Free Market Foundation, to talk to you and to the media about this. Because, you know, what I say is we've sort of lost Robin Hood and become the Sheriff of Nottingham in our healthcare. Thank you.
Okay, I think those were a lot of food for thought there, and particularly on the way forward and how we're going to kind of push back against these bad regulations that are coming out that are adversely affecting low and middle income individuals. from my perspective, I think it's a concerted effort on behalf of the government to try and kind of cut off the lower rungs of the ladder. So it started perhaps before the Medical Schemes Act of 1998 and then accelerated with this idea of social solidarity. So we saw kind of the PMB package starting to expand. And every single time you layer on something like that, it's another bad law on top of a bad law, and then you need another law to kind of come in and rectify that. So what it's done is it keeps on raising the price of private medical scheme coverage, and it's making it increasingly unaffordable for low-income individuals to be covered. And if you listen in the budget speech, we see that the medical tax credit is now going to be reduced. So that's now moving from almost attacking low-income individuals into going towards middle-income individuals. So and this is just, in my opinion, a concerted effort on behalf of government to push down this ideologically impossible path of introducing a national health insurance scheme, and it's just giving people no alternatives. So that's my take on it. I'm sure you have lots of questions for Patrick and Mike. Please fire away. There's no particular order, I don't think. I think you're happy to take them. Yeah. So if you have a question for Patrick or Mike, please ask now. Leon?
Yes, sir. Just the increase in healthcare costs. Mike, I think, because maybe you're one of the people in the audience. I've never been able to get clarity on whether the costs go up simply because people live longer. You see, the cost of food per person goes up because people live longer and eat more. So I don't hear the same statement being made about food care costs. So the question really, are healthcare costs really going up when you adjust A, for inflation, and B, compare like with like? You know, the cost of an aspirin, the cost of a medical procedure, or is, you know, to what extent is it simply a statement about age? In other words, healthcare costs are not going up, or are they really going up when properly statistically analysed?
It's a very complex issue. But it's a good question though, because I think it's worth highlighting where a lot of the problems come from. I mean, obviously, healthcare costs are made up of a combination of the actual unit cost, like what a doctor charges as a fee, and then multiplied by how many times it's utilized by people. So all over the world, there are utilization increases in healthcare services, and that's, you know, there are the factors of us living longer because of technology. There are factors of us utilizing services more because of aspirational reasons or the consumption of healthcare. But I think in the South African context, the concern for me is that because of the prescribed minimum benefits solely being focused into secondary and tertiary level of cover, the primary care component has been stripped away, so that people are only insured for those high levels of cover. So we go straight to the specialist, we go straight to the pediatrician, we go straight into those high level cares, instead of, you know, if you can prevent a stroke, if somebody is diagnosed with high blood pressure at the age of 40, and they get treated for it instead of having a stroke or a heart attack at 50. It's all those sorts of things to me. And the whole system, in the South African context, our system is upside down. Like, we should be having more primary care to prevent the higher cost of the tertiary care. I mean, all the stats that, you know, something like I showed you there, our demographics are getting worse and worse over time. And it just, all of those things start piling the pressure on. So it's a multitude of factors. But I do think the way our private healthcare system is structured is totally illogical. I mean, we should not be having this prescribed level at the top, because ultimately all the preventative stuff is being stripped away and it disappears, and that just makes our problems worse. I hope that answers that question.
Mike, could you comment, please, on the national health system in the UK, which the media there describes as in crisis? Is there any comparatives?
I don't really know much about the NHS, what I would read. But look, you know, I mean, I think the world over, you have in your developed economies, the problem there is very specifically is aging, and the growth of those aging populations. If you take America and Japan, I think if I remember the stats, by 2030, nearly a third of their population will be over the age of 65. You know, that starts to really put pressure on. Is it like that graph I showed you with the age, you know, it just gets worse and worse. So developed economies have very different, or they have problems, but for very different reasons than developing economies. But I mean, look, you know, my opinion of NHS, I think it's probably one of the best national systems in the world. I mean, it does have its problems, and I think we all have those problems. But if you look at the expenditure of health in the UK versus, say, the US, it's incomparable. But yet the UK is able to still deliver a relatively good level of care.
I think a couple of observations there is that in developed countries also there is a culture of entitlement. So people believe that if there is something wrong with you, then you need to be cured. So do not resuscitate is not well received.
Yeah.
So as markets evolve, we will probably also get, the costs will go up because people will believe that if they have a disease or something and if there is a cure, you will get it. And this is what the medical aids, for example, have seen with cancer treatments.
Yeah. Well, it's the curative approach as opposed to the preventative, yeah. So we take a tablet and we'll be fine. I think we all suffer from that, to be honest.
Do you have any questions about that?
Yes, please. You said that somebody needs to do something about the Constitution. I have heard Patrick speak on, I had the privilege of hearing him speak. I'm just not getting when somebody is going to take any of these matters to the Constitution, to pursue the constitutional level. And so we're saying it's great that we're all here, but when is and who is going to do something? Sorry, Patrick, I'm not sure Patrick knows the answer, but...
It's just such a long and expensive issue. I mean, there are many issues in the regulation that have come out for insurers recently to me. There's a new thing called the policy order protection rules, which are completely vague, and it can be a criminal offence. Now, you can't have a vague law which leads to criminal conduct because you've got to know what you're doing wrong. And there are dozens and dozens of examples. You know, since they did away with a sort of law commission idea where all acts were done in a big building in Pretoria, and now have become departmentally, you just get worse and worse drafting and things which you wonder if they've even read the Bill of Rights before they start, or understand the principles of criminal law before they start drafting, and to me it's a great difficulty. You know, there's a South American country, I've forgotten which one it was, but where you can go to the registrar of the constitutional court and say, please give me a piece of paper, and you can tear off a piece of paper and write down, you know, can the constitutional court please look at this issue, and they will look at it through the registrar and say, yes, this is a serious issue, we better go and look at it. I mean, you should be able to go there with my speech as a person who's losing their policy and go to the registrar. And that should be access to justice. You see, we can't have justice which is so expensive. And you know, I looked the other day, this is a bit of an aside, but when they had that Mkandla case, and you remember the president withdrew his case just 2 days before, there were 21 advocates in that room. 21 advocates. Now, every advocate would have an attorney and an article clerk and a junior. I mean, the cost of that room must have been too awful. And that was a very simple issue. What did the section in the Act say? So we need better access to justice. That's my other great message.
Yeah. So my question summarised is anybody going to pursue this matter?
So to the best of my knowledge, no, not at this point. But this is one of the reasons why we have. So the purpose of a media briefing is multi-pronged.
I mean, one of the ideas is to educate the media on something that they might not necessarily have been looking into before, but the other kind of strategy is to raise awareness amongst the general population about this and then hopefully draw out individuals that might say, we'll go down the constitutional court road challenge or something like that. So, I mean, the job of the FMF is to raise the profile of the issue and to get people like yourselves writing into the press and saying, look, my policy is going to be cancelled. I'm outraged by this. my private healthcare, I'm going to lose it. It's one thing for the government to use taxpayer money to pay for poor individuals, but it's another thing altogether to interfere with private arrangements between insurers and individuals. So I think everyone here should be outraged, and they should write to the letter. So they should write letters to the editors, they should write opinion editorials, and they should phone into the popular radio stations voicing their dissatisfaction with this. So there's various ways of affecting the climate of opinion and changing opinion within society. So I mean, the legal route's one way, but writing letters and things like that is another route.
And in certain democracies, people write to their MP.
Sure.
One also hope that you know, people like the unions should be interested, because that is their members affected. Business, what they call they're going to lose group personal accident policy cover. I mean, all those people should be involved, but lobbying them and getting them to do something as a group is not easy.
And people don't also know where to write.
Yes.
One of the things I hear a lot about the NHI is that it is likely to promote efficiency and equality through a single buyer model. And so maybe, Mike, I wonder if you could comment on the performance of a centralized versus decentralized model in terms of things like purchasing and deployment of capital, as well as the ideology of equality and how these things should work. What is your take on what centralization will do in this?
Look, in my opinion, I don't think a single fund has any advantages. It turns, I mean, especially in the context of South Africa, it's just going to be drowned in bureaucracy. The thing with healthcare, and this is a real concern that government still holds this relatively naive view, is it's the idea that a big single fund can negotiate good prices and get discounts. Healthcare doesn't work like that. Healthcare is about value. It's about the effectiveness of the intervention. Are we diagnosing correctly? Are we treating properly? So that's the treatment protocol. Two doctors may treat differently, and one gets better outcomes. So therefore, it's more about sharing data between providers that we start progressing towards more efficient and effective care. So the idea of a fund, I think it's almost like looking for the silver bullet that's just going to solve all our problems. But a decentralized approach is far better. I mean, if you look at South Africa, it's a very simple example. The HIV rate in KZN versus the HIV rate in the Western Cape are miles apart. They have completely different healthcare needs because of that. So if you have a centralized fund procuring services at a central point, how does it then cater for the different disease burden that exists in the two different regions? If you decentralize it, you can cater far better for the problems that you have and perceive in that area, rather than having this top-down approach which dictates, one size fits all. Mm. Hope that answers.
Yeah, when I drive home every night, I go to the top of Sandton Drive, and there are these three massive buildings that Discovery are building just to run their affairs. And they've got efficient systems. You can't imagine that in a bigger scale.
Sorry, you're first, yeah.
Yeah, I'm just, Patrick, I'm always concerned about a legislative approach, because, I mean, it's confrontational and it's expensive and it takes time and so forth. Why did it get to this position that one can't influence the thinking and that there be sufficient insight before it gets to a legislative process?
You know, I don't think it's the lack of that. I've got a client who has been in and out of offices for 3 or 4 years now, just knocking on doors right up to ministerial level. And all these points have been made. It's just, somebody puts their head down in National Treasury and says, we've been messing around for 15 years, we've got to do something now. Forget about the fact we're not ready for it. It has been done. And Mike, you've been involved in lobbying, and you've made speeches. I read a very good thing you did.
Yeah.
A couple of years ago.
I think it's quite sad that we got to this point, because a lot of lobbying has been done, a lot of engagement has happened. I mean, nobody wants to really go the legal route and go and challenge.
Yes.
It's time consuming, it's adversarial. I mean, we're regulated by the FSB and Treasury now. Let's assume in our business it's just a non-option for us, because we're going to we'll be targeted. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just, this becomes unfortunate. But yeah, so But it's a good question. I mean, it's like, why? Because why have they just ignored it?
I think this gentleman had a question, and then...
Yes, just carrying on from what the lady said. When you have a single fund, it's highly monopolistic. And in terms of our state, it's going to be very, very prone to corruption.
Mm.
Just look at SASA, that's a pretty good recent example. And when you're talking about getting the suppliers to different areas, that brought to mind, well, what about education with getting textbooks to schools? Are they even going to get that right? So this is a very, very serious concern.
Yeah, I think the Road Accident Fund is probably the closest thing that we'll have to the NHI at this point, and that's an absolute disaster. If you can just extrapolate the numbers from that, it will require an absolute army to administer the bureaucracy around the NHI, which would be much more complicated than just simply paying out for accidents and things like that. So, I mean, that's a kind of classic example of why a centralized national health insurance would fail. But I think the more important point is that the national health insurance is something that they would like to provide free healthcare for all. But that's not a particularly good use of scarce taxpayer resources, because if you're spending in one area, it necessarily means that there's less money available for something else, education, policing, something like that. So those who can afford to pay for their own healthcare and take responsibility for their own lives should be allowed to do so. But with regulations like this that are coming out, it's taking away that responsibility and that freedom that South Africans have fought so hard for.
I just wanted to make an observation. I think that in South Africa we've got to the point where the only thing that anybody understands is a determination by either the Competition Board or the Constitutional Court. And I have said at other forums that somebody should put together a crowdfunding arrangement for that, so that there's an anonymity, because there is, as Mike's describing, there is such fear in commercial arenas that those businesses will be targeted. So they'll win a little battle, but they'll be destroyed in the war. So, you know, really, something like that needs to happen.
Why isn't the Brazilian example being followed? Is it ideological?
I've just used the Brazilian model just as an example to show two public and private together. I don't know it in great detail, but...
In terms of maternal health, etc., they have much more community and involvement. One community worker for 35 families, that's the kind of ratio that they've got. And that's across the board.
You see, I mean, to my mind, I look at our current public health system, and while it's got a lot of problems, I mean, it's, you know, if you take this from national budget to provincial down to right through to the district health authorities, well, the district health authorities are then responsible for the healthcare in those regions. And you know, if they were functioning with proper public service administration and the providers that they've got in there, I think the system would work pretty well. I mean, I don't see why it would take it away from what it is now. And it's established, it's there, it's in place, and yes, we know the problems. But it's like almost every other public service department's got the same management problems. So I think retaining it in its current structure, but with obviously better management from the top would be the route to go. I mean, interestingly enough, the Brazilian system, I mean, their philosophy, which I do know, is that they give either tax credits or subsidies to private providers and facilities and insurers to actually come into the market, to actually say it's attractive. So that, because if they grow their 50 million private to 75 million, then that's another 25 million people that don't rely on the state. Mm. And remembering that everyone buys healthcare, private healthcare, voluntarily. No one's forced into it. Nobody makes it a compulsory thing. Because I mean, why do we buy medical aid? Because we want to make sure we're covered. I mean, healthcare is such an intimate and emotional product, because you want to make sure that you have the best healthcare. So if you can afford it, you will buy it. Mm. So if you make it available, you know, give the structures that you don't have to actually get involved in it. Just create the subsidies, provide the incentives, healthcare will grow, because people naturally will buy it.
Hi.
for coming out to speak to us about this.
Pleasure.
Treasury's head of tax and financial sector policy, Ismail Munmat, has come out to defend demarcation regulation, saying that they're trying to protect consumers and curbing current market abuses in the market. What is your view on how those abuses, all those bad practices, can be minimized in terms of short-term insurance?
You know, that phrase, and it appears quite often in the document that I mentioned, is that, you know, there's actually been no abuse of the market, because everything that insurance companies have done from 1998 to now has been lawful. And the Supreme Court of Appeal, there was a case that the council took to the Supreme Court of Appeal, they said, what you're doing is lawful. That is why they're changing the law now. And they do make this case out that somehow the insurance companies have been doing something they shouldn't have been doing and destroying medical schemes. And there's really no basis for that. In 57 pages or anything else that I've read from the gentleman that you just quoted, and despite being invited by contributions made by the public. In fact, that document says what people said, and then they give the answer. Sometimes they don't give an answer at all to the question. But there's no abuse, because nobody has done something they shouldn't have done by law. They provided a product which has been useful to people who can't afford medical schemes.
I think he was speaking more to people claiming on hospital cashback plans. You spoke about it briefly with regards to people saying they're in hospital so they can claim,
yes.
You know, in working out arrangements, some sort of collusion with the medical practitioners themselves.
Can I tell you? Okay, I mean, we've actually had experience of this. So there is fraud in South African insurance market. But I don't think throwing out the baby with the bathwater is not the answer. I mean, you're going to have fraud. I mean, South Africa has high levels of fraud, but it's not just the insurance; it's everywhere. So rather than throw everything out because there's some market abuses happening, and it's not necessarily the insurers; it's consumers colluding, you know, possibly sometimes with doctors. I mean, we've actually had evidence of it, and I'm not saying it's widespread either. I'm saying it happens in pockets, but it's a reality of life. Fraud happens, so we can't now just say we're going to, to draw lines through the phrase you use, to draw lines through people's rights because market abuses are happening. I mean, that doesn't make,
really
doesn't make any sense.
Insurance fraud is universal. It's like saying, well, look, you know, people are claiming for an extra bicycle every time they have a theft at home, so let's take away householders' insurance because people aren't using it. Go and rely on the police, please. Doesn't make any sense to me.
I think a good analogy would be say there is definitely fraud in the medical schemes industry, so let's get rid of the medical schemes industry. I mean, it's not rational.
Sorry, if I can make an observation, at a Norton Rose event, they also mentioned that in India there is a website that educates the consumer. So the way to stop abuses is to stop putting regulation down at the top that people can't actually understand, and teach the consumer to actually police.
Yeah.
And then you will do a lot better than legislation that not everybody understands or can even begin to implement.
Yeah, educate and regulate. That's a wonderful catchphrase. Do you have any other questions? Any other burning issues? Well, thank you everybody for coming today, and I think those were two great presentations. I really enjoyed both of them, and it was fantastic having both of you come to the Free Market Foundation today. Please join me in thanking Patrick and Mike.
Thank you.